Hello everyone, Derek Johnson with Tatango.com. Today we have another TCPA case review with Joe Bowser from Innovista Law, home of the TCPA Defense Force. How are you doing, Joe?
I'm doing well, Derek. How are you?
Good. It's a little hard here on the West Coast because we're going to be talking about Buffalo Wild Wings today, and it's about 11 a.m. and I'm getting hungry, so if I end this conversation short, you know where I'm going.
Okay.
So this review is a TCPA text message marketing case review, and this is for Meeks versus Buffalo Wild Wings, or BWW. So
B-dub.
Okay, yeah. We only have, I think, one here in Seattle, so it's kind of newer on the West Coast than it is on the East Coast. So let me review kind of what led us to this case, and then I'm going to kick it off to you, see what we missed, and then see what, you know, actually happened, and then how text message marketers can learn from what happened. So it looks like this person, plaintiff is March Meeks, so that's their name, March Meeks, alleges Buffalo Wild Wings misuses phone number, and this was back in July of 2017. And it looks like this guy went to a lot of different Buffalo Wild Wings. You know, I don't have a problem with that. They serve some good wings. And it looks like he went, and I've done this before at different restaurants, not at Buffalo Wild Wings, but he went into a restaurant and I guess there was a line, maybe people waiting to be seated. And he gave the hostess his wireless telephone number and to be like, hey, text me when, you know, the table is ready. And
right.
I've seen this done at many different places. And I think back in the day, they used to give those little discs and it would shake and vibrate and you would run back to the restaurant. Now, I guess they're doing it via text message. And it looks like they were using, this wasn't like a an app that Buffalo Wild Wings built. They were using a app called No Wait app.
No Wait.
That makes sense. So No Wait app. Yeah. So essentially the text message, So he gave the phone number to the hostess, the person at the front, and they essentially said, we'll text you when your table's ready. But then when his table was ready, or maybe before, I'm not really sure, Buffalo Wild Wings, and I guess maybe even No Wait, they sent some text messages to him that were more kind of like marketing in nature. Do I have that kind of correct?
Yeah. So as I understand it, when he got that message saying, you know, you're in line, we'll let you know when your table's ready, embedded in that was a link in the first restaurant to No Wait's platform so that you could download the app and use No Wait wherever it's available and wherever, whatever restaurants participate. And then in the second restaurant, he got a link as part of the, you know, the reservation process to download Yelp's app.
Okay,
so he went to both of those messages. He got a link in the first case to download No Wait's app, and in the second case to download Yelp's app.
Okay, but he was going to, he received two different kinds of text messages essentially, but he was going to two different restaurant locations and putting his number in. This wasn't like they started text messaging him after he left the restaurant. This was in response to him signing up at each individual location to get the message when the table was ready.
Right. He seems to have been offended by the idea that there would be a hyperlink in the text.
Okay, because usually this would be considered like an informational message, right? Because this is, it's an information. It's, hey, your table's ready. You've requested this message. So that's what it is. Does he have a problem with the fact that it has kind of gone from an informational message to a marketing message?
That's the crux of it.
Okay. And What is the difference? Why are there certain requirements for an informational message that maybe aren't there for a marketing message, and that's why he's able or why he thinks he can sue?
Well, the level of consent required under the TCPA does vary based on whether it's an informational message or a marketing message. And the marketing messages require that prior express written consent that we've talked about that has a number of elements before you can send an automated text with promotional content.
So that's like the, you know, reply yes to, consent is a condition of purchase and, you know, you're going to receive auto.
Consent is not a condition of purchase.
Consent is not. Sorry. Now I'm getting hungry. So all those things in the text message, which when he gave his phone number for an informational message at the front of the restaurant, they didn't have to, or they didn't think they had to, because it was informational, disclose any of that info. It was just, this is going to be a one-off. informational message.
Right. Which he got, right? I mean, he did. He never said, you didn't tell me when my table was ready. He didn't allege that you texted me about some completely unrelated thing. It was just that embedded in there as part of No Waits and Yelp's software platform that the restaurant was using, that was embedded in that particular text message.
Okay. So it would be kind of looked at as like a hybrid message, essentially. It has a little bit of marketing, maybe marketing, and I'm kind of putting in quotes because, you know, I guess, what did they decide? Because the intent of the message was informational. But yes, maybe there is a little bit of marketing component. Maybe, yes, they did stretch it a little bit by linking even to like Yelp, which has nothing to do with the whole reservation kind of thing. The No Wait thing I can understand because it's like, hey, you download that, you know, to have a better experience when you're waiting. But what did the court decide, or how was this resolved?
Well, ultimately, the key question for the court was whether Yelp was actually the sender or the initiator of the message, to use the term of art in the law itself.
Okay.
So the law prohibits a person from initiating a text message under certain circumstances. So the key analysis for the court was, who sent the message? Was it Yelp or was it Buffalo Wild Wings? And the court took the FCC precedent that we have available to us, and we have the U-Mail and the TextMe cases on the one hand and the Glide case on the other. And the key facts that the courts now care about are who's deciding whether to send the message, who gets it, and when do they get it. Content is a mixed bag. The FCC didn't find that is, you know, outcome dispositive. So in this case, Yelp and No Wait, and Yelp owns No Wait, incidentally.
Oh, okay, I didn't know that. Okay, so that's where their little relationship was there. Okay.
Exactly. And why the user experience was different at each restaurant, I don't know. Yeah. Maybe a question for Yelp, but who cares? But what matters here is who decided whether to send the message, when to send it, and who are you going to send it to? And the court found this one to be a pretty easy case based on the plaintiff's own allegations in the complaint. So Yelp got out on a motion to dismiss, which is the very first inflection point in a lawsuit to get somebody out of a case, which is often hard to do in a TCPA case.
And so I said the case was Meeks versus Buffalo Wild Wings. Was it Meeks versus Buffalo Wild Wings and Yelp originally?
Yes.
Okay. So, and really, from a plaintiff's perspective, you always want to kind of include everybody that could have some kind of, you know, insurance policy or deep pockets and you'll try to go after anybody. And essentially they went after Buffalo Wild Wings and Yelp, which also, if No Wait was its own company, I bet they would try to go after them as well. You lump everybody into there. So the first thing that happened in that case was Yelp said, nope, not my problem, and got themselves out.
Well, as a defense attorney, obviously you'd hope that the plaintiff's attorney does their homework and only brings claims against someone when those claims are viable. Mm-hmm. In this case, it illustrates that there really wasn't a viable claim against Yelp,
okay,
because it had no involvement in the key decision points about whether to send the message, who gets it, and when to send it. So you are right that it is a common page in the plaintiff's attorney's playbook to sue everybody under the sun. But defense counsel would obviously take issue with that approach.
Okay. So then it became Buffalo Wild Wings versus this person. So it used to be, you know, this person versus these two companies. That company got removed. So they went to court and got removed, essentially. So then what happened with the person versus Buffalo Wild Wings?
To be determined.
Okay.
So that part of the case is actually getting transferred a couple hundred miles south to the Central District of California in Los Angeles, where the other defendants are based and where the operative transactions occurred. So the plaintiff happens to be from the Los Angeles area. So the case is actually getting punted down to federal court in the Central District of California. This particular decision came out of the Northern District. So this case was filed in Oakland.
Okay.
So this judge is from Oakland, and she punted the case because everybody else besides Yelp is based in LA or thereabouts.
So what can we learn, you know, because obviously this will, you know, have some learnings once actually this case is resolved. It seems like, number one, it's always the person that, you know, meets those qualifications of when they send it, you know, what they send and all those things. And Yelp, in this case did not meet any of those. So they were, you know, removed from the case. So what can SMS marketers kind of use that information to better their campaign, or just maybe that makes them aware that they are responsible if they're clicking send on the message, even if they're like a marketing agency representing a brand?
Yeah, I think that this case is important and illustrative for both the brands that use SMS platforms and the platforms themselves, so that everybody's on the same page about who's doing what and, you know, what those decisions mean for purposes of TCPA liability. Now, it so happens that the plaintiff in this case, Mr. Meeks, kind of pled himself out of court as it relates to Yelp, because his allegations really didn't support a claim against Yelp, because he said Buffalo Wild Wings took all of the operative decisions. But you can imagine a circumstance, and there have been cases where the platform provider has a more active role in the marketing campaign at issue. So if a platform provider decides to bring upon him or herself the some of the key decisions, the outcome could very well be different, right? You could have both companies be liable when you share in the responsibilities of deciding, you know, when you send the message, who's going to get it, what's it going to say, things, you know, the key decisions about how that's going to go. And so the court distinguished a case, for example, against Twilio, where the court there in the Wick versus Twilio case basically looked to the plaintiff's allegations on a motion to dismiss, which again, on a motion to dismiss, you have to take everything the plaintiff says as is true. But because Twilio had certain language on its website about how it helps, you know, tailor the customer's campaign and help them develop those marketing campaigns, the plaintiff was able to seize on those public statements to create an issue of fact about where the roles and responsibilities between Twilio on the one hand and its customers on the other started and stopped. So if you don't have a clear line between what the brand does on the one hand and what the platform does on the other, you might be both in the case for longer than one of you wants to be.
Okay. So it really comes down to is, you know, everybody involved in the messaging can be brought into a case, whether it's a platform provider like Tatango, or this platform provider, you know, is kind of the Yelp / No Wait app. I guess they would be the software provider, and
that's
then
right,
the brand. But it really depends on, you know, who has control of those things that you mentioned, you know, and that really can determine, you know, who's on the hook for, you know, a TCPA violation.
Right, right. You know, as we've talked about before, the FCC created exemptions for carriers and fax broadcasters, but when it came time to, you know, bring those exemptions forward to SMS platforms and application providers and the like, it kind of got cold feet and created this totality of the circumstances test that courts have now distilled into the test that we see in this Meeks case, where you look at those, you know, essentially those three key questions of, you know, whether you send the message, who it's going to, and when you send it, to determine who is the initiator of a given call under the TCPA. So again, this case just illustrates the point that everybody needs to come in with eyes wide open about the roles and responsibilities of the respective parties, so that if you're absorbing those responsibilities, that's fine. You just have to understand the risks that are associated with them.
So I guess this is good, I guess, case law for software providers, because it essentially says, you know, hey, we are not the people that are clicking send, and if they're not, we are more of a software provider. We're providing kind of a software that allows the customer to do all this. That always kind of brings out the point for me, and the advice we always give is, you know, well, it's nice to listen to your software provider. You know, I always recommend going to a third party for legal counsel, because in this case, you know, hypothetically, now Wait and, you know, Yelp could have, you know, let's say Buffalo Wild Wings could have thought they were, you know, doing compliance and helping them with those things. But at the end of the day, you know, Yelp and now Wait have just removed themselves and said, hey, not my problem. That's Buffalo Wild Wings. Even though they use our platform, we're not really involved because we are just a platform.
Right. It's like buying a car, a gun, whatever else. Like, you are the user. You decide how it's used.
Yep.
And as long as Remington isn't helping you aim the gun,
yep,
you're the one pulling the trigger.
Yep, exactly.
So liability rests there.
With the person making the action.
Right. Yeah. So the platform providers, and we do this when we represent platform companies, we analogize to either carriers as the quote unquote dumb pipe, right? If the carrier is just facilitating a transmission of the end user's choosing, they're not looking at the content. They're not looking at the whys and wherefores of why a given text or call is placed. And in those circumstances, the carrier is not liable. And if you spam somebody with your Microsoft Outlook account, Microsoft, you know, no one thinks that we should hold Microsoft liable just because I misused my Outlook account, right? So too with the platform providers, if you're just providing the tools to send the messages and the connections to the, you know, the aggregators and the wireless carriers, well, then you're not making any of the key decisions, and compliance should rest with the brand who's making those decisions.
Yeah. So essentially, for a learning for a text message marketer is, even being a software provider, I hate saying this, but do not rely on your text message marketing software provider, you know, for your compliance. Essentially, you know, you are responsible for it as a brand.
Right. Okay. Right. It can get messy when the platform provider gets out of the platform provider shoes and starts to look and feel like a marketing agency. But you're absolutely right. I mean, everybody should do their own homework and understand where the lines are drawn, both in terms of responsibilities and thus liabilities.
Yeah. No, that's great. Now, what about, and I don't know if you can comment on this, but what is your take on kind of the mixing of transactional, like one-off messages, and then mixing in marketing type messages into those transactional messages? Is that something that you recommend SMS marketers don't do right now until this case gets resolved? Or how would you advise SMS marketers to kind of take that second component, which is the, now that there's this case where, you know, it's informational, but then they put a little marketing, maybe marketing, I don't know if it would be considered marketing. What's kind of your take, and what are you kind of advising clients right now?
Well, the dual use cases are always, you know, very fact specific. So it's hard to give a blanket answer to that, but you really want to look at, you know, what is the ultimate end goal, and you follow the money. A case came out last week where a website was trolling Craigslist looking for people selling their cars. That court found that just because the company also sells cars didn't mean that a text message to a particular Craigslist advertiser was necessarily a marketing message. But there are cases on the other end. The Best Buy case is a common example, where Best Buy had a rewards program and they were texting people that, hey, you should come in and use your points. Your points for your rewards club are about to expire.
Yeah, makes sense.
The Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals, which covers Washington State, Oregon, California, and some other big markets, held that those text messages were dual use and therefore had to comply with the higher level of consent requirements. So the case law is not clear on this, and you really want to look at how that campaign is architected to figure out, are you crossing the line, and ultimately what level of risk are you willing to tolerate? Because it's very hard for, you know, an audit and a compliance attorney to give a clean bill of health for a mixed use campaign unless you really get into the weeds about how are we following the money, what is the user experience, and what are the expected outcomes of that particular message. In this case, obviously Yelp, and NoWait survived having that embedded link to download the app. And I think that's common with app providers when they push out the message that the user chooses. So there definitely is precedent for having that link to say, hey, Johnny's on such and such app. Johnny would like to invite you to use the app. It's Johnny sending that message. And most people aren't going to sue Johnny, your friend, for sending you that link, even if the app developer facilitated the sending of that message. But for the mixed use informational and promotional campaigns, the devil's in the details. And ultimately, it typically comes down to a risk tolerance that we work through with our clients.
So, and if it is mixed use, like let's say that has been established, so informational marketing has a higher threshold, and you know it's much more complicated to get an opt-in than it is just to send one informational message. If it's mixed use, you would have to go with the highest one, which is the marketing, right? Like,
correct.
Okay, so you can't just be like, well, it's mixed use. One half of it's informational, so we're just going to focus on the informational opt-in type stuff. They have to do it for the marketing side.
Right. Because once you hit that tipping point into mixed use, you then, because it has a marketing or a promotional element, you do need to satisfy that higher level of consent.
And so this customer right now, they are suing Buffalo Wild Wings for essentially advertising something that isn't even Buffalo Wild Wings, right? Like they're advertising the No Way, which kind of sucks for Buffalo Wild Wings because they're like, oh, great, you guys, Yelp and No Way just, you know, exited the thing, but that was the advertisement. That's the thing that got them in trouble. If it was just, you know, hey, your table's ready, there would be no issue here.
Well, he's suing them for unsolicited messages, period.
Okay. So is he saying that it's because it's marketing messages, or he just thinks that, you know, any message is a violation of his rights?
It's unclear from this particular opinion, and it's going to be for that Central District of California judge to sort that out. I can tell from the report here, the case, that Buffalo Wild Wings also filed a motion based on his consent to get the messages. So Buffalo Wild Wings has clearly teed up the issue. I just don't know how it's going
to
shake out.
So this would be a really great case to kind of follow, because there is a lot of cases when you're sending, you know, an informational message, but, you know, maybe you want to include an ad at the bottom, or maybe it just is advertising in nature, you know, the message. Right. And it's hard for some informational messages because you're like, well, it's telling you that, you know, the table's ready, but, you know, can you tell them that you should check out the specials as well, you know, when your table's ready? So there, it's not as cut and dry as people think, where it's just like, you know, here's your information, that's all, you know, even...
Right.
Yeah, there's a lot of instances I can think about.
And as you said, it's very unlikely that Buffalo Wild Wings would get anything if a user downloads the No Wait app.
Yeah, so it kind of sucks for them.
Unless they're coming back and have a better experience at Buffalo Wild Wings, but obviously it works with many, many restaurants who subscribe to that service.
Interesting. So, okay. Do you know how long it will be until we'll do a case review on kind of the outcome of this, or what factors play into how long this could last for?
It'll probably at least several months, because the case has to get redocketed in the new court. The judge has to get assigned. Presumably, the parties will be asked to comply with some of the preliminary procedures with the filing of any new case. And then they'll refile the motions and let that judge who's going to hear the rest of the case resolve those motions. So it'll probably be several months.
Okay.
And the Central District is very busy.
Okay.
So their turnaround time between even argument and decision is one of the longer longer periods in the country.
Oh, interesting. Okay. And what happens here? Because I know it's anywhere from $500 to $1,500 per text message. From reading this case, maybe he got two or three text messages, somewhere around that range. That's not enough to go through all this work. So would his kind of goal most likely to like certify like a class and essentially say like, you know, hey, I've been harmed, but that's only $1,500, let's say. But I know there's a lot of other people out there that also got messages. They can join us. Am I correct in terms of what we think his strategy would be, or why he's even wasting his time on three text messages?
As it stands, the docket doesn't suggest that he's filing this as a class action. So yes, in the abstract, you would expect him to have done that, but that hasn't been the case.
Okay. Interesting. Maybe he's just really angry about those couple text messages.
Yeah.
Man, that sucks. I feel bad for everybody involved, obviously. But it feels like Buffalo Wild Wings, you know, it would definitely be a violation of the TCPA if they, you know, if you signed up to know when, and I see this all the time, you signed up for, you know, to know when the wait or when your table is going to be ready. They text message you an information message, and then 3 days later, 10 days later, they send you a coupon. Like, that is a blatant violation. That's where companies, it's a slam dunk case against the company. It's like, well, you did not get any marketing, you know, consent. And we saw the same thing with, like, Jiffy Lube way, way back in the day. People would call in, you know, and they would give their phone number when their car was ready or something along those lines. And then, like, a year later, they took all those phone numbers and they sent him a mass coupon. And it was like, okay, that's pretty obvious that you're violating the rules there.
I found out a couple of weeks ago that my barber recently switched marketing platform companies because I started getting these messages and I certainly didn't consent to get them.
Yeah.
And I talk to the owner and let her know that she should probably ask some hard questions and about why.
I think that's part of the problem too with our industry is most small businesses, even large businesses like Jiffy Lube, I think they rely too heavily on what the software is capable of doing and what the features and functionality allow them to do, rather than looking at the law. Because I know there's a lot of software providers that let you do really anything on their platform, and their kind of response when, you know, these issues come up is, well, we're just the platform. We give you all these tools, and you have to use the tools correctly. And we see that with barbers and local pizza shops. I see that all the time in my local community. And usually you see it on a grand scale with these TCPA, you know, case reviews when they just have deeper pockets usually. But yeah, it's a little scary. And that's why I recommend, you know, everybody, you know, review the videos we have online, just kind of get yourself educated enough that you don't make stupid mistakes. And you have enough information to go to, you know, legal counsel and go, hey, I'm thinking about this. This is my concern. That's a much better conversation than just going to an attorney and saying, I have no clue what I'm doing. You know, kind of a little background, you know, and educate yourself.
Right. No, we've had clients from, you know, big to household names, and you would be surprised that even companies with very sophisticated compliance programs and risk management programs, it's just something that's fallen through the cracks, or they felt like they mastered it in 2012.
Yep.
And then the world changes on them and they're not, you know, they're not keeping up to date. And there's serious exposure.
And your firm, I'm not trying to make this an advertisement, but your firm only does TCPA, right?
We do related things around the telecom ecosystem. So we started as telecom attorneys and evolved into TCPA defense attorneys. So we've never represented a plaintiff, for example, but so we understand how the telecom ecosystem works. So we do represent carriers, but in the main, our core practice area is the TCPA. But it's that telecom understanding that we think gives us a competitive edge in many of our cases, because we know the hard questions to ask and understand how the networks interoperate and understand the call flows. And so we're able to get under the experts' assumptions and really figure out some of the key issues at issue in some of these cases.
And it's confusing, the TCPA. It's always changing, where I've heard this before from even small businesses. They go to their, you know, their general business counsel, you know, in their town, or, you know, even if a large business, they go to internal counsel. And yes, maybe they know how to review contract law. But the TCPA is something that I know you're busy all the time. Thank you for your time here. a regular attorney just couldn't keep up with all the stuff that's happening. And that's why I do recommend, and I think you do too, is always go, you know, to either a law firm that has a specific, you know, section of their law firm that focuses on these kind of laws, or go to, you know, a firm like yours that only specializes in this type of thing.
Yeah, the TCPA is the second most common type of litigation in federal court. On the average day, about 5 new opinions get issued from courts around the country. Wow. In the last few weeks, we've had 3 very important appellate court decisions come out. So the law is constantly evolving, and it's definitely not something that you would want someone who keeps a passing eye on to give you expert advice.
Yeah, so. Yeah, because $500 to $1,500 per text message, that's a lot of money. This is not little, you know, fines or, you know, lawsuits. These are huge. And it's federal law, right? This is not like, you know, local municipality or something. This is federal law. It's pretty serious.
No. There is a well-armed militia of plaintiff's attorneys who are just trolling around for clients to bring new cases that are, you know, filed, you know, by the handful every day.
Okay.
So,
man, yeah, definitely things to take note in this. And it'll be interesting once this, you know, does go to court or they settle and see kind of where this ends up, because I think that'll have an impact. And I think for now, you know, for at least what I'm thinking is, you know, if you want to do an informational message, keep it informational unless you have, you know, unless you've really kind of thought through everything with outside legal counsel. But it seems like in this case, even, I don't even know if the risk was worth the reward. You know, just linking to a Yelp page, is that worth, you know, all of this kind of, you know, hoopla?
Right. Well, I mean, you know, for the, in the main, I'm sure that this kind of service improves your customer experience and endears you to your customers. And what the defense counsel in this case may have been thinking was, we don't have a class action. Here's a chance to get some good law in our back pocket, defend our platform, defend our business practices in a way where our exposure isn't the same as if it were a class action. So they might have been happy to use this as a test case to get that good decision in their back pocket so that people who may have been on the fence about using the platform say, oh, okay, you know, it's been tested in court at least once. It's passed muster. Let's go ahead. And I feel more comfortable now, you know, using that platform.
So
if I'm Yelp, I'm feeling pretty good about this because I had a low risk test case to evaluate whether I'm really the sender of the messages through my platform.
And I guess you could even see, you know, let's say Yelp and No Wait has removed themselves, but maybe they're even helping Buffalo Wild Wings to prove out that their system and their clients are all protected, you know, if this goes the way that they want it to go. Because it kind of sucks to leave, you know, as a software provider, leave the bag, you know, with Buffalo Wild Wings, because I think this hurts right now Yelp and No Wait, because yes, even though they got removed, their client's still stuck in this, you know, frustrating lawsuit, which if I was a restaurant, I'd be like, oh, I don't want to use No Wait because look what happened to Buffalo Wild Wings. Maybe there's even some, you know, they're hoping that it goes one way. Maybe there's some, you know, relationship there that will kind of help No Wait eventually, you know, with, hey, our client was exonerated plus we're exonerated. This is great case law and now we can go forward. I didn't think about like working it from the backwards angle.
Sure. No, I think B-Dubs has a very good consent argument. So I envision that they get out of this pretty quickly. But, you know, it's America. You can't stop people from suing you. Yep. So I wouldn't put all of the sins on Yelp's lap. I mean, you know, it's something that in the main, I'm sure, improves the restaurant's perception with their consumers and should be a value add. And you just kind of have to get over these humps and, you know, test it in court. And then once you've gone through a couple cases, the plaintiff's attorneys will probably try to find another victim.
Yeah, easier stuff, like easier things to go after. Okay, perfect. So that was a TCPA text message marketing review. Obviously, we'll have a follow-up. And when that happens, we'll link to it below. Who knows how long it'll take or if they settle. That was Meeks versus Buffalo Wild Wings, which originally was Meeks versus Buffalo Wild Wings and No Wait and Yelp kind of combined there. But they were obviously thrown out of that case by, obviously, they threw themselves out. Anything else I'm missing here? It sounds like, you know, just a lot of kind of what we've heard, but then also some kind of unknowns here. So I think it's more just kind of a wait and see type case, except for the platform. It's been established time and time again that the platform is the platform. And really, at the end of the day, it's the person deciding when, who, and how they send the messages.
Yeah, I think the safe and unsafe lanes for the platform provider and brand are established.
Okay.
Right. The whether, the when, and the to whom questions are the key questions. And if those are clearly divided between the brand and the platform provider, I think it's clear where the expectation of liability should sit. But I agree that the Buffalo Wild Wing test case really is having that embedded link that financially would redound to a third party's benefit here, Yelp's.
Okay.
So we'll see if they can get it.
Super interesting, as always. Yeah. Well, again, my name is Derek Johnson with Detango.com. We have Joe Bowser from Innovista Law, home of the TCPA Defense Force. What's your website? Because you have a bunch of good resources.
You just nailed it. www.tcpadefenseforce.com. tcpadefenseforce.com.
Cool. We'll link to it most likely in the description so you can get all that. They have a great blog, great resources.
We did blog about this case. Oh, I blogged about this case last week. So we'll put a link in there.
Perfect.
We'll get a link in there.
That sounds good. Always on top of it. I like you guys. That sounds good. Well, again, thanks everyone for tuning in and check back for the next TCPA case review. Thanks,
everybody. Thanks, Derek.
Thanks.